Good evening all to the 72nd session of the Weekly Huddle. I am your host Anoop and joining me today is my friend and co-host Praneet. We are cardiologists working at CARE Hospital. As most of you know the Huddle is an unscripted audience level interaction where we address common clinical scenarios and sometimes we pick a topic which is as basic as today's topic. The basic premise of the Huddle is to bring our casual discussions into a more organized platform like this one by sharing our ideas. But in today's discussion, it won't be too much of science and complex patient management, but more about the very practical aspects of how we treat patients. And today's topic was inspired by that one video that I showed you, and partly also to the point that a lot of these things, we take it for granted. We assume that all of us know what is going on, but at times we end up practicing what we feel comfortable. And then it eventually becomes our habit, which we never break, whether it is right or wrong. So having said that, let me start today's discussion. And as most of you know that this is not a speaker and audience model, as in anybody who has got any thoughts to share, they can unmute themselves or raise their hand. And as a gesture, you please wait for the other person to finish their thought before you speak up. I will read out the case for today. I will ask my co-host Praneet to give his initial impression, and then we will go down the list of our attendees asking their impression as well. I do want to thank my guest for today. That is Dr. Srikanth. He is a pulmonologist at Yashoda Hospital. And I'm really appreciative, Dr. Srikanth, to spare your time in joining us and sharing your thoughts as well. We will be asking individual questions to you as well as the time progresses so that you can also share your thoughts about today's discussion. So Praneet, this is a case I saw actually a few weeks ago and I have modified it just a little bit so that it focuses on our today's discussion. So it's a 65-year-old male. He was admitted with non-ST elevation MI 3 months back at our hospital. At that time, he underwent PTCA to proximal LAD. He stayed about 2 days in the hospital. He had an uneventful recovery and he was discharged without any problem. At the time of admission, he was an active smoker, which with appropriate counseling, he does claim that he has quit smoking after that index hospitalization. He is diabetic and he is hypertensive for quite a few years. And they both seem to be reasonably controlled. They are not perfect, but they seem to be reasonably controlled. So at the time of visit to my OPD, that is 3 months after the index hospitalization, he complains of cough and sore throat for the past 1 week. And in the last a day or two, now he has also started experiencing some dyspnea and shortness of breath where he is unable to walk more than a few steps, and even at rest sometimes he gets shortness of breath. There is no any particular orthopnea or PND. His day is pretty much disturbed with cough, and there is nothing particular about it coming at night or at daytime. His clinical history and examination is suggestive of euvolemic status. I'm not bringing individual components into it, just to keep it concise. His vitals at the time of visit in the OPD, blood pressure was 148/90, so slightly higher than what I want. Heart rate is 90s, again, slightly higher, probably because he is in a little bit of distress. His saturation is 97 at room air. I didn't mention his respiratory rate. I don't have the number, but he was breathing okay. On examination, he did have inspiratory and expiratory Vs, which were audible on auscultation. He did come with initial workup of an ECG and echocardiogram, which both were normal. I did order a chest X-ray, which also was normal in terms of there was no any pneumonia patch or any fluid overload or anything. The medication that he takes are pretty routine for his ailments. He's on dual antiplatelet, high dose statin, 50 milligrams of metoprolol daily, telmisartan 40 milligrams daily, cilnidipine 10 milligrams twice daily. He's on long acting nitrates, dapagliflozin for his diabetes, metformin as well as vildagliptin. And then he takes pantoprazole, multivitamins, and other lifestyle medications. So because his current presentation was more respiratory in nature, that's what I thought, I decided to stop metoprolol in view of wheezing. That is again debatable, but I wanted to give him a benefit of doubt. I started him on long-acting diltiazem, 90 milligrams twice daily, which I thought was dose appropriate for the metoprolol 50 milligrams that he was taking. And I added prazosin long-acting for blood pressure control. I also wanted to give him a short course of antibiotic because I thought his current presentation was triggered by some URI-like event, which may have happened a week ago. It could be viral in etiology as well, but I just wanted to cover the base, the fact that he is elderly and has got cardiac problem recently. So the discussion point is, A, if you want to comment on his overall treatment plan, you are free to do that. But the main discussion that I want to bring up is that would you put this patient on inhaled bronchodilator therapy at this time? Now, the fact that he's wheezing, but he otherwise is saturating fine. How would you choose the mode of drug delivery? Do you give MDIs or metered dose inhalers to these patients? Do you give rotahalers? Do you start nebulizers on these patients? Or there are some other tips and tricks that you use? And I hope we can discuss more about this mode of delivery. What do you choose? Why do you choose? And everything else around. And when you start, if you do want to start these patients on inhaled drugs, do you only start with short-acting beta agonist, or you always combine it with inhaled steroids, some anticholinergics like ipratropium, or plus-minus long-acting beta agonist? How do you handle it? And then I'll ask my other attendees for their comments, and then we'll ask Dr. Srikant about how he does it. And the last question is, do you prescribe ancillary equipment like spacer I can think of, but is there any other devices that you think help in drug delivery for these patients? So Praneeth, long case, but the questions are very precise in nature. Take it, how would you handle this? And then we will go down the list. Praneeth.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. So this patient who seems to be having an bronchospasm because of his possible intercurrent illness, and he's wheezing and he's a bit dyspneic. So because there's a possible bronchoconstriction with his history of smoking, I believe there is definitely a benefit of adding bronchodilators to him where he gets better. And now the whole point of discussion today is about delivering these bronchodilators or inhaled drugs. So I would recommend definitely a bronchodilators for him. And the choice would be a combination of a plain beta agonist, preferably like a salbutamol kind of a thing. Now, depending on his visit to me, I will decide on which one, short acting versus long acting. Inhalers, the commonly available Astaline, which contains salbutamol, shorter acting agent, will be my first drug. I would ask him to use salbutamol and ask for a review and see how is he responding, because until this episode he was doing fine. So I don't think he's having very significant reactive airways, and I hopefully with this illness, if it is taken care by antibiotic and this short course of bronchodilators, hopefully he should be doing fine. If he continues to have issues, then probably I would have considered him giving longer acting bronchodilators plus minus addition of steroid and plus minus addition of an anticholinergic. So for this case, a short acting bronchodilators like an Astaline inhaler using 3 to 4 times a day, depending on his requirement, and continuing the antibiotic, which you already said. Now, regarding the usage or mode of delivery, the two things being common in OPD practice is either a rotahaler and a metered dose inhaler. I would try to assess the patient whether he can do or use the metered dose inhaler accordingly, because I believe it needs a lot of coordination, where you press the pump and while the mist is released, you equally need to inhale at the right amount of time. And if this coordination doesn't work, then the drug doesn't enter the lung and the whole purpose of giving MDI is gone. So if someone who is smart enough, I would recommend them. Equally, I try to show them the video of how an inhaler works. But for someone whom I think do not have good coordination of pressing and inhaling, I would prefer a rotahaler, which is reasonably easy because there is no demand of coordination there. You just break the capsule and you breathe in as per your requirement. So for someone like coming from tier 2 centers or who do not understand where it becomes too complicated, Rota Hiller will be there. For even them, I show the short YouTube videos which are easily available and ask them to take the things. Nebulization, I believe, is in relation to hospitalization or those patients who are very dyspneic and not able to breathe in or have a deep inhalation. So this patient, nebulization probably is too early. Regarding the use of spacer, spacer will be a good addition with the use of metered-dose inhaler. And for those patients who are not having this coordination, again, spacers will come handy where the mist which is released from metered-dose inhalers can stay there in the spacer for quite some time. And again, this challenge of coordination can be eliminated. So if the patient already has a MDI, and I would ask him to add a spacer whereby the drug delivery can be ensured. And otherwise, Rota Hiller will be something which is easy. And this is what I think of this patient.
So Praneet, few follow-up question. If MDI has a problem, why not a Rota Hiller for everybody? What is the problem with Rota Hiller?
The problem with Rota Hiller, I don't see particularly a problem with this thing. It's like you need to, some effort to take in where you have to take the capsule, put it in the Rota Hiller, twist it and do it. Versus with an MDI, it is more easy where you just pull out from your pocket and just do it. Otherwise, I do not see much of a difference. At least from my knowledge, I don't see much of the difference between Rota Hiller and MDI. It's a matter of a bit convenience. Maybe if there's something else, I would be equally interested to know.
Do you know of any data set that says that Rota Hiller is better tolerated by patients than MDIs?
No, this is my thought process.
Last thing, most of your cardiac patients are on beta blocker. Why asthaline in this patient? Why would you give beta agonist? Are you not worried about heart?
The one which is bothering him more needs to be addressed. So equally controlling the rates are equally fine. Removing his problem is necessary. So it's a trade-off for the bargain that we need to do. So I would still continue the cardioselective beta blocker, which is beta 1 selective. And these... continuing both of them in this patient.
Okay. All right, Praneet. Let me continue my discussion with the rest of the attendees. Dr. Shankar is here. Dr. Shankar is a senior physician who has been a regular attendee of Huddle. Sir, this patient could very well be in your OPD asking for your opinion. How would you take it with regard to bronchodilator therapy? How do you initiate therapy in these kind of patients, and what is your mode of delivery? Shankar, sir.
Good evening to all. This patient is a chronic smoker, elderly person with COPD only. And now he has got either viral or a bacterial infection. He developed acute exacerbation of the COPD in the mild form only. He can be managed as an outpatient one. And in this mild disease, we according to the COPD gold guidelines, it is a stage one, and it comes under ABCD category, it comes under A. So where only short acting either muscarine antagonists or beta agonists are indicated, or combination. So since this patient is a known case of coronary artery disease, he may develop with this short acting beta agonist like salbutamol, levosalbutamol or terbutaline. So patient may develop either tachycardia or tremors. Sometimes, very rarely, hypokalemia is also noted with these bronchodilators. So I prefer to give short acting muscarinic antagonist, which is ipratropium. This ipratropium, it has got a little longer action also, unlike diatropium, which is more longer acting one. So this is ipratropium. It is a short acting muscarinic antagonist. I prefer to give this SAMA, that what we say. We can give even SABA also, that is short acting beta agonist also can be given, because it is a beta 2 agonist, but mildly it is maybe having a beta 1 action. So it is not contraindicated during exacerbation of COPD, patient associated with the coronary artery disease. So this short acting salbutamol can be given in a patient with a COPD and CAD. But I prefer to give SAMA only. He better tolerates. Suppose if he doesn't get relief with this muscarinic antagonist, then I will add salbutamol. This combination of SAMA and SABA can be given in this mild disease of acute exacerbation of COPD. Regarding the mode of delivery, I prefer to give MDA with a spacer. DPI is a dry powder inhalation. It is a powder, in the powder form. So, but whereas this meter dose inhaler is in the mist form. So, the particulate size is very minimal compared to the powder. So I prefer to give MDA spacer, but recently few more deliveries have come into the market, that is the synchro breathe, actuated inhalation. That mode of delivery is also there in the Cipla company. So that is known as a synchro breathe. If the patient is not happy with the MDI or synchro breathe, the DPI is happy. Suppose if the patient is used to DPI, most of my patients are used to DPI only. Whether it is asthma or whether COPD or anything. See, they feel happy because they don't know how to inhale with even in the 10th visit also, they will show in a wrong way they inhale. So all the time, every time we correct the technique of giving inhalation, but still there will be faulty administration of the drug. So most of my patients, I prescribe a DPI. In the elderly people, so they will be happy with it. They will use and wash and use again. So DPI can be given, but in this case, I prefer to give MDA with the spacer, so we can expect a correct amount of drug in a mist form because of faster onset of action. This is regarding the bronchodilator, the mode of delivery and all. The antibiotic we have to give in this case, either I prefer to give amoxiclav, augmentin duo 1000 milligrams BID, or cepadoxime 200 milligrams BID for 5 days. Regarding the metoprolol can be safely given in patients of COPD. Suppose if the patient, if we think that in this patient, this bronchospasm is because of the bronchial hyperreactivity with the metoprolol, other alternatives are mentioned, but already patient is on calcium channel blocker. So again, giving diltiazem, another calcium channel blocker, but though it is a little different, non-hydrodiazepine. So whether to give combine both dihydropyridine and non-dihydropyridine, instead of that, the metoprolol can be continued because the bronchodilator will take the bronchospasm of the condition. So metoprolol can be continued. And second is, a patient is found to be a little hypertensive, 148 by 90. So instead of changing the drug, we can increase the dosage of cilnidipine can be increased up to 40 milligrams also. But though we limit it up to 20 milligrams, but it can be given 40. So 5 milligram or 10 milligram can be increased here in this case. Or telmisartan, we are giving only 40 milligrams here. It can be increased to 60 milligrams or 80 milligrams. That is, or this is everybody's experiences regarding the calcium channel blockers. Cilnidipine, the amlodipine is he preferred over cilnidipine in this case because it is little potent also, though half the dosage of the cilnidipine. So I prefer to, if at all, if I change cilnidipine, I will change it to amlodipine 10 milligrams daily so that we can see the blood pressure, whether it will drop to normal, optimal level. These are my thoughts. I will be happy if I am enlightened more by the August audience.
Thank you so much, Shankar sir. You did touch a lot of points. And this synchro breathe, I should probably learn more about it. I have never prescribed synchro breathe or whatever it is. And the DPI also, I had my own reservations, which I hope will get it cleared. I'm not a fan of DPI, but that's my own personal bias. So let us see what others suggest. Let me ask Dr. Srikanth to share his thoughts about today's discussion. Dr. Srikanth, you heard our initial discussion about what we think pertaining to this case and how we as a non-pulmonologist are managing this patient to our knowledge. If this patient were to come to you or if you were to guide us how to manage this patient and fill in the gaps that you have noticed in our discussion, please take it from here. The floor is yours. Share your thoughts with us, sir. Thank you. Sir.
First of all, good evening to all the audience, and I wish to thank Dr. Praveen, Praneet probably, sorry. Hello, Praneet. Hello, am I audible?
Sir. Yes, sir, you are audible. Yes. Please go ahead.
First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Praneet for the invitation. And coming to today's topic discussion on the case scenario, as Dr. Praneet and Dr.
Shankar.
Our Shankar, they have right.
Okay, sir, I'm sorry, I by mistake muted you. Could you please unmute yourself?
Hello?
Please go ahead. Sorry about that.
As far as today's case is scenario, probably a 65-year-old male who was a smoker, quit smoking recently and had a cardiac event 3 months prior, probably because smoking induced or age related or his because of his comorbidities, diabetes and hypertension related, presenting symptoms looks like an exacerbation of COPD. So, hello?
Yes, sir. We can hear you. Please go ahead.
Yeah.
We can hear you.
Presently, looking at the case scenario, case is looking like an acute exacerbation of COPD, probably a mild exacerbation because he's not that much dyspneic, probably grade 1 to 2. And cough with a minimal of wheezing and probably and just a minute. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Regarding the first point, what we have discussed as inhaled bronchodilator therapy at this time, probably in an acute exacerbation, probably everyone would be taking to a short-acting bronchodilator, whether it is SABA or SAMA, as probably he had a recent cardiac event. Probably Dr. Shankar has said that he would prefer probably a SAMA over SABA. That would be a right choice in this case. If at all he gets relieved with the SAMA, probably that would be ideal. But if at all he doesn't get a relief, probably an added combination of SABA and SAMA would be ideal for him. And probably coming to the mode of drug delivery, whether it is MDI, Rota, NEB or others, probably is he will be categorized into mild COPD exacerbation. Probably from my side, I would prefer a MDI with a spacer in this case, and rather than Rota or nebulizer, because he is a 65-year-old, coordination problem probably might be there, or actuation force will not be sufficient in this age probably. So cutting down all those things and pressurized meter dose inhalers with a spacer would be ideal for this case. And coming to other things, inhaled steroids, anticholinergics, long-acting beta agonists, and I would prefer a ICS plus a LABA-LAMA combination in this case, because he's into a mild exacerbation phase. So inhaled corticosteroids would be ideal for this case.
Okay, sir, there are a few direct questions which I would like to ask you for this.
Yes, case. Yes, sir.
You mentioned spacer, and I'm just asking from both a patient as well as a doctor's standpoint, and I think these are two basic questions that we sometimes don't ask ourselves.
Yes, sir.
And at times it becomes humiliating for us to ask in front of an audience, but here okay. I am. So a spacer, there are two models available. There is a small, tiny spacer, and there is a big, like a jar spacer. Does it really matter?
Yes, sir. See, patients, first of all, doesn't prefer inhalational devices. They would rather prefer oral medications over inhalational medications. But with a due counseling and the initial days, if at all, in the initial few days, patient is comfortable with the device what we provide, definitely a shorter spacer, shorter one, that what we call as a mini spacer would be better in rather than for accepting the device and for usage.
Perfect.
That is my point of view, sir.
Absolutely, sir. And I think these viewpoints and these thoughts, I don't think we'll find it in any review articles or textbooks. My thought process is, and this is purely based upon my biasness, that the DPI model, which is the dry powder inhalation, because of the particle size, I think they stick to the mouth more than going into the lungs. Is it based upon any scientific principle, or you think this is bogus?
So these all devices, whether it is a dry powder inhalation or a pressurized meter inhalation or a nebulizer, our main motto is the drug delivery, sir. So basically all these devices, the drug delivery is optimal is around 20%. So whatever we take, only 20% will go to the peripheral airways, sir. The remaining 60 to 80% odd will be deposited somewhere or the other in the oropharyngeal airway or in the large airway. So we should consider whether the patient will be practicing what we teach him, whether how to use a dry powder inhaler with a probably with a rotahaler or a inhaler with a spacer or without inhaler also. It all depends on how patients takes it. After, first of all, in the first probably session, we explain him once or twice in the OPD basis, and it all depends on whether he takes it at the same discretion what we teach him in the OPD.
Sir, in cases like these, like the index patient that I mentioned, do you let them fail once with a short-acting drug before you put them on steroids, inhalational steroids I'm talking about, or do you
start? Yes, sir. Primarily, we should start with a short-acting only, sir, because he is into mild exacerbation phase. If at all the short-acting drug fail, then only we would prefer an ICS LABA-LABA combination over the short-acting, sir. But initially, we should start him on a short-acting muscarinic agent or a short-acting beta-2 agonist.
This whole idea of oral care, if you are on ICS, is it it is all urban legend, or you think it has got a scientific basis that we need to pay special attention to oral care if we are prescribing ICS?
Yeah, definitely, sir. Definitely, oral care is a must when we are preferring any inhalational device, because the 80% of drugs, whatever inhalational mode, whether it is ICS, LABA, or LAMA, or a combination, the drug gets deposited in the oropharyngeal airway. So whether it is a drug which causes multiple infections, probably fungal infections in the oral, probably he is a 65-year-old, this patient, what we are talking about now, he is a diabetic patient. So probably chances of fungal infection would be there. We have seen many patients who were using with an incorrect technique, coming with oral fungal, oral candidiasis or other fungal infections. So oral care is a must when we are giving inhalational therapy.
And sir, if you could please share with us, what are your tips and tricks that you tell your patients regarding oral care?
Yeah. When we are initiating the patients on inhalational therapy, so first of all, we'll teach them the correct technique, how to use it, whether it is a DPI or an MDI. And after every use, we should instruct them to gargle their throat at least once or twice after every use. So at the second point is, I would prefer my patients to take this inhalational devices, preferably before having any food. So that if at all the patient forgets gargling their mouth or throat, probably with food, this gets ingested into the stomach.
Sir, that before food point is absolutely well taken. I think it is spot on. Even if they forget to gargle, they will not forget to eat.
Yes.
Food, so I'm sure it will get washed off.
Yes.
And
the second thing is, before having anything, the ease of taking the medication would be much better compared to taking after food. So that diaphragm will be much better working before food rather than after food. I would prefer this.
Absolutely, sir. That makes sense. One very common question that patient asks us, if we prescribe you two inhalers, whether there need to be a gap between the two inhalers or they can take back to back.
Two inhalers means two devices, sir, or?
Yeah, two devices, I'm sorry to say. Yeah, if there are two MDI two devices or rota devices.
Okay. If at all they take two devices, the preferable choice would be an ICS LABA, and the other thing would be a LAMA, the long acting, probably. If at all we suggest them use two devices, at least a gap of 10 to 15 minutes would be ideal.
And sir, give us a thought process. Why a gap? Why they cannot take back to back? What's wrong is going to happen?
So whenever we take the inhalational day devices, the drug which will be delivered to the peripheral areas, first of all, there are three mechanisms. One is the deposition thing, which will happen with 1 to 5 microns particles. The second thing is sedimentation, where the particles tend to sway away in the airways. So at least to particles to settle down in the airways, at least some amount of time we should give rather than holding on to the other device very fast.
That makes sense. And then how about in the nebulizer? One of the common questions that is asked is, sir, can we put 2 respules in the same vial and then inhale, or should we do one and then wait and then do another one?
This is another tricky question where, the common things, what in age-old things which are available right now, the common thing is Budicort and Diolin, whatever, which are available in any emergency setup. So Diolin contains ipratropium and salbutamol. So mixing them two is already mixed. Probably it is okay when using in nebulizer form rather than this inhaler form.
Okay, I request anybody in the audience member, if you have any thoughts, any questions, any comments, please feel free to unmute yourself, or you can ask your question in the chat box as well, and I'll read it out for you. Shrikant sir, one more question. If this patient were to come to you, what is your stand on aminophilins? What do you think? You think there is any role in this?
No, sir. Looking at the case scenario, if at all the patient, similar patient comes to my OPD, I would categorize him in a mild COPD exacerbation phase where he might get off better with a shorter acting bronchodilators only without requiring much of theophylline or aminophylline. He is into mild category, mild exacerbation.
Okay, so I'm guessing what I'm reading from you is that when it's a mild exacerbation, then we don't need to give aminophylline.
No, sir.
Okay. Do you see in the modern context, is there any role of aminophylline in any case, or you think that this is a drug which has outlived its utility?
Sir, still in very severe cases where we have tried all the methods except this aminophylline. Aminophylline few still works in some cases, some exacerbations, severe, very severe exacerbations. Sir.
Okay, and in my notes, the last question that I have written for you is what Shankar sir mentioned about that syncobreathe. Could you guide us a little bit about to a person like me who has never heard or seen?
Yes, sir. Syncobreathe is a breath actuated device, sir. So this is a new entity, but it has been there in the market probably from five anywhere between 3 to 5 years, sir. It was initially withdrawn from the market, but recently it has come up again. So syncobreathe is auto actuated, sir. So mainly patient doesn't have to press the canister himself. So it is just actuated according to the patient's breath.
And in the Indian context, if you could just tell us about availability, pricing, patient acceptance, what is your experience in using syncobreathe?
Syncobreathe, definitely, sir. Syncobreathe, if at all the patient is young, probably less than 60 years, able to understand the technique, and if at all he reproduces in our presence, then definitely syncobreathe would be much easier to use rather than a inhaler with spacer.
So syncobreathe also is used with spacer? Sorry if I misread you.
It can be used, sir, but it's not required actually.
Okay. Okay. One question that came on the chat box is, what is the role of oral bronchodilator tablets in the current era of all these inhalational drugs and everything?
Oral bronchodilator therapy is altogether added form in any exacerbation or any long-term usage in bronchial asthma or COPD, sir. But coming to our scenario, if at all he fits into a mild case where probably, if at all he improves with our inhalational therapy, probably oral bronchodilator might not be required.
Personal question directly to you. When was the last time you used tablet acetylene?
Sir, I have not used till now.
Okay.
Probably I used once. Probably that was 6 to 7 years back, probably.
Because I can remember in my MBBS days, all we used was tablet acetylene. And
only acetylene was there. Now, yeah. Apart from that, no other medications were available at that time.
Right. So I'm sure a lot of us can recollect our MBBS days where patients yes. would come back with literally shaking from top to bottom.
Yes, sir.
And they would literally say that we can feel the engine running inside us. But yes. in the current practical era, I don't know how much of the oral bronchodilator tablets is of help.
No, sir. Acetylene, no. Right now, we are not using any oral beta 2.
Box. One question that came on the chat box is, SAMA is preferred over SABA specifically in post-infectious exacerbation. Is there any thought about it that in infection, SAMA is better than SABA?
No, sir. Both are equally effective.
Okay. And what is the take on, this could be for anybody, including Dr. Srikant, what is the role of routine use of prokinetic agents in these patients who have exacerbation? Because the whole idea is sometimes the gastric reflux yes. may be potentiating some of these symptoms. So do you routinely use or advocate prokinetics in all this?
Sir, for elderly patients, for those who are multiple drug therapy patients, and those who I am prescribing a LAMA, acting muscarinic agents, probably a prokinetic agent probably might be better for these patients, elderly, multiple drug therapy, and on long-acting muscarinic agent, especially.
Okay, anybody else has got any other questions, comments, or thought about this case that we managed, both from the cardiac standpoint as well as from respiratory standpoint? Shankar, sir, you are unmuted. Please go ahead.
Regarding the inhalation corticosteroid, when the patient has got high risk individuals only, in a high risk COPD only, we prefer to give inhalational corticosteroid because there is a modified MRC scale is there. That is a modified Medical Research Council dyspnea scale. So there 0 to 4 points are there. Then another scale is there, that is a CAT scale, that is the COPD assessment test. So depending on this MMRC and the CAT, we categorize this COPD into four stages, A, B, C, D category. So A and B, they are minimally symptomatic, they are less symptomatic. Then C and D they are maximally symptomatic. And the risk score is there. Depending on the exacerbations in the past year and regarding the hospitalization, depending on that, the risk score is also there. So coming to this inhalation steroid, we give in C and D category, and especially in the D category, we give inhalational corticosteroids, either fluticasone or the budesonide. Second thing is, regarding this, apart from that, the systemic corticosteroids also sometimes we are supposed to give in the acute exacerbation. were for a short period only. The 0.5 milligrams per kg body weight, roughly around 30 to 40 milligrams per day, minimum 5 days or maximum up to 10 days, or 10 to 14 days. But beyond that, we are not supposed to give, because this inhalational corticosteroids or the steroids, systemic steroids, they do precipitate pneumonia. Complication will be there. We should watch for the pneumonia. So I don't give steroids, especially in A and B category, and even in the C category also. And I've restricted to only D category, where moderate to severe COPD with a high risk, more than 2 exacerbations per year, with one or more leading to hospitalization. In that situation only, apart from LAMA, DABA, I give inhalational corticosteroids. Regarding the SAMA and SABA, here, when the SABA is given, that is a short-acting beta agonist is given, the patient complains of tachycardia, tremors, rarely hypokalemia. If they are seen, actually we switch over to SAMA, the short-acting muscarinic agent. If the SAMA, with the SAMA, patient complains of dry mouth, or sometimes retention of urine in the elderly individual. So we should be very careful. So if such symptoms are there, hesitancy in passing urine or obstruction to the stream of the urine, or some visual disturbances, or dry mouth, then I prefer to give SABA. So these two things we should keep in our mind. But submaximal doses of combination is an ideal one. In my practice, I give SABA-SAMA combination in a submaximal dose.
Thank you so much, Shankar sir. I remember using these drugs in my training program, and there were a lot of this discussion about which one is more tachycardia producing, or which one is more detrimental to the cardiac health. Is it beta agonist or it is anti-muscarinic receptors? One has to remember that their final outcome in the sympathetic system is the same, whether you go by beta agonist or you go by ACH blockade. So the science is not very clear out there, and that is where I think that our individual practice patterns, they definitely guide us in how we should manage individual case scenarios for the lack of a discrete data set in this regard. There was some question in the chat box. Santosh, you asked about COVID. I'm going to skip COVID question here because I think then the whole discussion is going to go towards COVID. But I will put up your second question here. Shrikant sir, this is for you. What is the role of Montelukast and other antihistaminics as a routine use in these kind of patients?
No.
As the patient we are talking about is a COPD labeled, so probably Montelukast has no role in these patients.
I would think the same thing. Shankar sir, what is your thought? Do you routinely prescribe Montelukast in all wheezing patients or antihistaminics?
No, sir. Only allergic background is there. We are supposed to give this Montelukast or levocetirizine or any antihistamine. Otherwise, there is no role at all. And to our surprise, even in USA, this Montelukast is a very expensive drug. Here, we use it as like a water. But now, every patient of COVID now is getting Montelukast or Montelukast. In this case, when is COPD is documented, there is no role of Montelukast or antihistamines. But the corticosteroids have got a role, even in the chronic bronchitis where there is exacerbation. When we do eosinophil count, if it is more than 300 absolute eosinophil count, we do give even steroids for a short period. I What is Dr. Srikant's comment?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, Srikant, sir, eosinophil count in this kind of patient, does it change your management?
Sir, elderly males, usually COPD is a fixed airway disease. So some patients do tend to have asthma and COPD as an overlap syndrome. So some patients, if at all that is there, probably Dr. Shankar, sir has said, eosinophil count, and probably if other airway, if at all inflammation is there, so definitely it has a role.
Do you check eosinophil count in all such patients, sir?
Routinely, COPD patients, usually we don't check eosinophil count, sir. But if at all the patient gives history of allergic symptoms of running on and off, or a family history of allergy or asthma, then probably we tend to.
Perfect. Thank you, sir. One of the other question that is asked, and this is the last question we are going to take. I believe Dr. Bhuvneshwar writes, many times patients have symptoms with ecosprin. How do you manage that? I believe this will be a question for cardiologists. Praneet, what is your thought? Your patients have respiratory symptoms with ecosprin? And if yes, how do you manage?
So I don't know whether aspirin is the culprit causing this wheeze and respiratory symptoms. And it's like the risk benefit analysis, and I believe the incidence is very, very rare. So I would tend to manage them with these antihistaminics, etc. But I would still continue aspirin. For me, I haven't encountered anything aspirin-induced asthma scenario. So my experience is zero in this regard.
Thank you, Praneet. And I spare the best for the last. We have Somaraju sir with us. Sir has been a regular attendee of Huddle for quite some time. Sir, you heard our discussion. You heard the questions that I put up to Dr. Srikant, and you heard the clinical case as well. Your thoughts on the case and anything, gaps that we have missed.
Thank you, Anup. And I learned quite a lot listening to all of you. And the last question asked, about aspirin and precipitation of asthma, you must always check whether the patient has nasal polyposis. That aggravates the situation. The chance of aspirin-induced asthma are highest in patients who have nasal polyposis. And coming to other issues, most of the things are already discussed. Though literature will sometimes be confusing, in a patient who, when you had obvious wheeze and dominant feature of wheezing, I would definitely stop metoprolol, and I would prefer to add evobradine and not diltiazem, as is suggested. Evobradine is very important to keep the heart rates in check in all patients with coronary artery disease at this age, for more than one reason. One is, though we may have stented the major arteries, they still have small artery diseases, and increased heart rate or tachycardia is not good. And many of these patients will also have some degree of LV diastolic dysfunction, and increasing heart rates will aggravate. Any degree of pulmonary venous hypertension with increasing heart rates and diastolic dysfunction will aggravate bronchospasm also. Then montelukast we often use in some of these patients who continue to have these problems and not in acute situation. And the other issue is, I would go out of the way to try to check whether this patient is continuing to smoke. Most of them don't tell you immediately. And other also go out of the way to rule out any evidence of obstructive sleep apnea. And having treated his asthma, this particular episode, it's very important to keep them on careful follow-up And also, once you think that you treated everything and it looks all right, it's very important to follow up with pulmonary function tests and rule out the possibility of a persistent, say, bronchospasm of some kind and asthma uncontrolled. Because symptoms are not always reliable and auscultation is not always reliable. Because a persistent continuing asthma is an inflammatory state, which will have indirect influence on coronary artery disease also. So that's what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Sir, point well taken. Few questions I do have for you before I let you go. So I note down your point regarding pulmonary function test. Once he recovers from this episode, I think that is absolutely, absolutely paramount. And sometimes this is very easily missed because the patient comes, he's feeling fine. You feel great that you have treated the patient. It's happy ending and everybody forgets. About your comment on evobradin and diltiazem, the reason why I was not very aggressive with heart rate because I thought that some of his heart rate was driven by his discomfort and dyspnea. And I thought if I could take care of his dyspnea, his heart rate would go down. But again, your point is very well noted on that, that heart rate reduction should be one of the targets of cardiac management. I did stop metoprolol. I do believe that I need to give them a benefit of doubt. So that is why I stopped on it. And last time we discussed about flu vaccine, and I think it becomes very important that when patients like these, when they recover, they should be extensively counseled for flu vaccine as well as for pneumococcal vaccine. Sir, my question to you is, how do you see aminophilins in cardiac patient when they have COPD? Can they coexist or you think aminophilins from a cardiac standpoint needs to go away?
With the presently available medications, etc., we hardly use aminophilin. We are using them extensively long time ago. As Dr. Srikanth already pointed out, we don't find enough evidence and enough benefit in continuing to use them. And some of these drugs are orally not well tolerated. They produce gastritis and other problems. And maybe they don't have a significant role in today's practice of bronchospastic disease.
And sir, last question to you is you mentioned about nasal polyposis. I have never checked my patient for nasal polyposis. Is it something that we should be checking more frequently? And if yes, how should we check it?
If you ask the patients, they will tell you. And sometimes you may have to just check yourself or ask. If you can't see that directly and for some reason or the other, an ENT consultation will help. Nasal polyposis is an important issue because these are the patients who are most predisposed to, say, aspirin-induced asthma. And Dr. Srikanth can highlight that more on that, actually.
So Srikanth, sir, getting back to this nasal polyposis business, I will share my experience. There was a time during my training where I had a lot of allergy symptoms. I took a flashlight and checked my own nasal cavity. While my turbinates were hypertrophied, they almost looked to me as if I have got nasal polyposis on both the sides because they exactly looked like polyps to me. I got so freaked out, I went to an ENT, I went through a scope, and ENT put the scope and said that these are just hypertrophy turbinate, they are not polyps. But from outside, they give you that polyp kind of appearance. They look lobulated and they give you a polyp kind of appearance. So I have never checked any patient for nasal polyposis. I wouldn't shy away from saying this. I do know that aspirin can not only induce polyposis, but also make it worse. What is your take on it in terms of what should we be doing as a cardiologist addressing this scenario?
Sir has said rightly that we should, if at all, patient is having allergic symptoms, like recurrent running nose or recurrent nasal symptoms, and for a cardiologist, from your point of view, if at all patient present, if at all you ask for the symptoms before starting him on any aspirin kind of drugs, we should check on an OPD basis. It is just on-site with a, I usually check for every patient for upper airways with a torch. Probably we can make it out. If at all the patient polyps are there, tribrids and polyps, we can make it out easily. If at all we do a routine evaluation for every patient.
Right, so this is one thing for my cardiology colleagues here, that since we prescribe aspirin so frequently, that maybe we should develop this skill set of identifying and differentiating turbinates from polyps. And if you think it would be very obvious, I'm sharing with you my personal experience that I was so convinced that I have polyps because it looked like polyps to me. And every time, even these days, when my turbinates hypertrophy, sometime when I look at it, it looks like polyp. It looks like a very nice rounded globular structure inside. So maybe there are ways to differentiate, and we should at least develop or learn this skill set to differentiate between the two. And if we cannot, then ask our ENT or pulmonology friends to help us out with. That is all the questions that I had in written on my paper here. Anybody else has got any other questions or comments about today's session? If not, then I may start winding up this session. Praneeth, your closing comments about what we discussed and how we did today?
Yeah, fairly common scenario that we see in our practice. And I think that is a valid discussion that we had on how to use, what to use, and understanding availability. So this synchro breathe again is something which is something which I learned today, which I was not aware. And I think that carry home message is whenever we prescribe a metered-dose inhaler spacer is probably a must, which is underutilized, I believe. At least I do not frequently prescribe a spacer, so I will change this in my practice. And using short-acting versus a long-acting, both the bronchodilators and muscarinic agents, with steroids again probably a low threshold for us to start is what I understand. Inhaled steroid, shorter acting, and not oral steroids. And equally educating the patients on usage and always ensuring that they are using the bronchodilators properly, and also emphasizing the importance of oral hygiene to prevent fungal infections is also well highlighted. And the importance on checking for the polyps brought up by BSR servers, again, highlight on this session. So definitely very valid learning points for me from this session. And the points added by Dr. Srikanth were also amazing for me. So a lot of points learned from today's session, though it looks very simple.
Thank you, Praneeth, and thank you, Dr. Srikanth, for sparing your time. I know evenings can get busy, so I really appreciate whenever professionals take time after their schedule for discussions as basic as this one. So really appreciate you spending some time with us. I'm also thankful to my attendees for participating in today's session. As you all know that all these sessions are recorded and they show up on YouTube and podcast at some point. So you can use your dead time to listen to all the previous sessions that we had. Srikanth sir, any feedback about today's session? Any constructive criticism is what we are looking for.
First of all, lastly, before ending the session, I would again thank Dr. Praneeth for giving me an opportunity. And I would thank you for sharing your thoughts, sharing the case, and I would thank Dr. Our physician. Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you, sir. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, and our sir. And before concluding this session, for this case scenario, as sir has rightly said, vaccination after probably 2 to 3 months would be ideal for him, because he is in 65 year age old category, recently quit smoking, but we should again check his smoking status. And probably right kind of drugs would be, would do better for him.
Perfect. Thank you so much, sir. And it is 8:11, so I would like to end this session here. I thank everybody again for participating, and we will see you all next Wednesday at 7 o'clock. Thank you all for attending today's session. Good night.